everyone. It's April 2nd. I'm Liz Brown Swanson, bringing you an RPV coronavirus update. This is our very first virtual edition of RPV City Talk. And right now I am actually sheltering in place at my house in RPV. And I'm being joined by our city's top leaders, RPV Mayor John Cruikshank and RPV City Manager Ara Maranian. Thank you, gentlemen, John and Ara, for doing the show remotely. And of course, we're trying to help do our part in preventing the spread of COVID-19. You all know we're living in unprecedented times right now. We've got so much information to share with the Rancho Palos Verdes community who are trying to just navigate life. And so I just want to start with the two of you guys. How is life going? We'll start with you, Mr. Mayor, because I know you did test positive and you had the coronavirus. How are you doing?
Oh, thank you for asking. I actually did catch the coronavirus, COVID-19. I did catch it early part of last month, the 19th through the 22nd, four really bad days of a really splitting headache. I had total lethargy. I didn't want to do anything. And then on Monday, the 23rd, I woke up and I felt great. And so I've felt great since the 23rd, and my self-quarantine has ended, and I'm back at work, although most of my employees are still working at home. But I'm able to get back to my semi-daily routine, and I'm very happy about that. Thanks.
You look great. Our city manager also looking good. Staying healthy. You are a force, Ara Maranian, and staying strong and healthy. I was going to ask, so how are you feeling, and how is the rest of city staff?
Because city thank you, Liz, and I'm really glad to be here and be a part of this RPV talk. Today's my first day back being at the office. I'm talking to you from my office. I was exposed to someone who had tested positive, so I self-quarantined for 14 days. It was quite an experience. I was working remotely and realized like how much time we put in when we're at home and we're working from our desk, but you know, playing our part in trying to help flatten the curve here. I'm pleased to report that I'm feeling well. I felt well. I was testing my temperature daily, just making sure there were no signs. I didn't have any symptoms. So then if I did, I could take certain actions. But I was clear, came into the work today. Feels good to be back in the office. You know, there are a few of us that are here today because most of staff is working remotely. I think generally speaking, the spirit here and my communication with staff, and I'm in constant communication with staff, just checking in, seeing how everyone's doing. These are unprecedented times, and staff is not immune to what everyone else is experiencing and the concerns and the anxiety that everyone else is feeling. We're feeling it too, and so we've got to make sure we check in with one another, and we make sure that if someone needs help, we're here to help each other out. So it's really just as staff, we're working together as a community as well.
It's really incredible, I think, how everyone's coming together and just trying to help each other get through this. As you both know, I had the symptoms of the virus. I was sick a few weeks back with the high fever and the cough, and it was very scary. I didn't qualify for testing when I called my doctors. They just said, keep doing what you're doing. I didn't have respiratory distress, thankfully, which at the time, that's what they wanted. If you had that, you could go in and get tested. And I've, you know, pretty much recovered, and the county now is offering free testing sites. So my husband and I decided yesterday actually to go and take advantage of that. We're waiting for our results, but like I said, I'm completely recovered. I'm sure I will come back with a negative test. So stay tuned for that. But you know, it is confusing. I think the main thing is you want to stay calm and not panic. Most of us get through this. But you know, just to figure out what to do, John, you've been through this. What do you want to share with residents? What advice do you have?
Right. So I did get tested, of course. Like I mentioned, I tested positive. And the reason that my doctor had me go get a test were a couple reasons, of course. I did have the symptoms of the extreme headache and a slight fever, even though I never had the respiratory issues. But because I had been in contact with someone that had the virus, my doctor recommended I get tested. I would say, and my wife ended up getting tested as well, and she ended up testing negative, even though her and I had been in the same house the entire time, went to the same event that I got sick. I would say for people that are out there, if they have the symptoms. And you know, it's interesting because my symptoms were really not what they call the symptoms. You know, I had a very slight fever, never had a cough or respiratory issues. I had a headache and was lethargic and slight body aches. But I had it. So those were my symptoms. So I don't think there's, I think the symptoms kind of are going to be different for people out there. So I don't think we should just say, oh, it's, if I don't have a fever, if I don't have a cough, I don't have it. I think if they feel severely ill at this point and, you know, whether they know they've been in contact with someone or not, I would definitely contact your doctor and talk to them about these symptoms, because I think it affects everyone differently. And so we want to make sure that if someone does need to get a test, that they get out there and get that test. I actually got my results 2 days after my test, which I was surprised it was so quick, because they were telling me, because I'm, you know, not someone that's like a super essential, like a fireman or policeman, that it would take a few more days. So I was pleasantly surprised, although I've had employees in my office, they've been tested and it's been more than a week and they still don't have their results. So I don't know what to tell people about that, but it's the testing is just work with your doctor, and if you feel like you're have some type of symptoms, I you know, ask your doctor about it.
Yeah, I would echo what the mayor said. I have a few friends who have tested positive and have come down with the symptoms. And I know a couple where they both experienced very different symptoms. I think there may be the fever is the common thing. You know, your body's fighting something. So it's clearly your body temperature is going to go up, but it's true. I mean, you should check with your medical provider and see if you need to go in.
Obviously, the city, I don't know if I asked you earlier, like if people are calling that don't know where to go, because there's more testing of becoming more available. The county has free sites. You can go on the county website. We're going to talk more about just the great information we can get on our own city website and call the county. I just want to go now to talk more with you, Ara, about just how the city is dealing with this pandemic in terms of following state and county guidelines and just, you know, what how we're monitoring the situation in the city to make sure we're helping our residents navigate this.
Yeah, you know, it's a good question. I mean, I was actually talking to some of my colleagues from the other peninsula cities earlier today, and we were talking about, you know, preparing for this emergency exercise, a peninsula-wide exercise, and we all realized we're going through that exercise right now. This is not only peninsula-wide. I mean, this is a pandemic, and so it's interesting. It's been a trial by fire. You can go through all these rehearsals and practices, but here we are going through a real life situation and how we're dealing with it. And I have to say, from my experience and having been in this position for just a short while, I think the most important thing that I've learned, and from the very beginning as the news was breaking and as we were learning more about this, to me, the number one thing that I wanted to make sure we were getting out to the public was information, because that's the most powerful tool here is information. And so as we were learning more about this, we created a dedicated page on the city's website that had a centralized location of all this information. We reported this out in some of our earlier council meetings in March about this web page. And we had John Hopkins University's information that was keeping track of the numbers globally, and we started putting out all the county information. And as that started to intensify, and as things started to change, and it became more apparent that we were all in a different situation here. I believe it was a Saturday morning. I had a conversation with the mayor and the mayor pro tem, and we started talking about what to do and how to convey the information, more information to the public. Immediately after I got off the phone with the mayor and the mayor pro tem, I assembled a team. We started talking. It was a Saturday morning. We were talking to each other till probably 11 o'clock that evening, and we put out our first community update. So, From an information standpoint, not only do we have the website where we've got all this information, we are now putting out daily updates. And our neighbor city, Rolling Hills Estates is doing the same thing. We are collaborating in putting out the information. So we're on this unified front as in terms of keeping the public informed. So information that I can't stress more how we need to keep the public informed. I think it helps people keep their mind at ease on the numbers, some of the resources that are available. We continue to do that with the community updates. You can receive them through social media or subscribe to the city's breaking news listserv, or just go to the city's website because they get posted there.
Now you're saying that you're monitoring daily and all the information is there, especially of course City Hall is closed through the Safer at Home order. I mean, public spaces, all of that. And you're giving all that updated information, including just sort of what's happening with the outbreak in our own city. John, if you could address what, I know today's April 2nd, so the numbers keep changing. What have we seen so far with the number of cases positive? And I know, sadly, that there's been reports of at least one RPV resident has passed. So, of course, our condolences to the family.
I want to go back to what Ara said. And this is a new city manager we're talking about, a guy that has basically started a job that's a different job for him. And he's basically in the middle of the biggest pandemic, one of the biggest pandemics the world's ever seen. And he's asked to not only do what a city manager does, but now he's being asked to assemble his team to figure out what type of information to get our city and our residents. And I know he's been nonstop on the phone with, you know, not just our residents and not just his staff, but also our businesses throughout our city, which we'll probably touch upon a little later in the show. But you're right. I mean, the numbers obviously change every day. As Ara mentioned, the idea is to flatten the curve and to make sure that we don't overwhelm our hospitals and our emergency people that take care of all of us. So right now, just from, you know, if you go to our website and you follow some of these links, you'll find that as of yesterday, and these numbers get updated, I guess, in the next, from the show, another half hour from now. So by the time people see this, they'll be able to get new numbers. Hopefully it hasn't exploded beyond what I'm about to say. But in Los Angeles County, there's a little more than 3,500 cases. Unfortunately, there's been 65 deaths throughout the county. And in Rancho Palos Verdes, we've had 16 cases. I've got to hope that I'm in that number. I don't know. I mean, I did get contacted by the county of Los Angeles. I'm assuming that's who's compiling these numbers. And they did confirm my positive test results. You know, these numbers do change. I want to add something, though, a thing to this. You know, part of our city and part of the, we've been talking about housing and our RENA numbers. And I know eventually we're going to get back into, you know, housing needs for the state. And I think we can all see that, unfortunately, places like New York, where they have high density, and where people are living one on top of each other, that might not necessarily be the greatest thing for our cities and other cities. It does seem like having a little more space to be able to shelter in place and to keep your quarantine distance, it does seem like places that are a little more spread out are maybe not getting hit as hard. So, you know, we'll eventually get back into more of these discussions outside of COVID-19. But I just did want to note that, you know, some of the higher density places are struggling a little more than the less dense places.
Yeah. Ara, can you just talk a little bit more about what the being the safer at home order means and where the community should and should not be going and doing? And the second part of that is I know on the city website there's a letter that's posted right from our sheriff station, Lomita Sheriff Station, asking people to stay off the public trails, things like that, where they're not supposed to be right now as we safe distance. Can you kind of go over all that, what that means to our residents?
Yeah, I mean, primarily the whole concept behind safer at home is, look, when you're in your house, and I could speak from experience, you know, having spent 14 days self-quarantining, you know, I realized I'm not washing my hands as often as I was, you know, when I'm out and about and, you know, just being very mindful of what I'm exposed to. So when you're at home and you're keeping yourself protected from being exposed to other people, you are now lessening the opportunity from catching it, because when you're out and about, you're exposing yourself, you're vulnerable. And so we're trying to remove that vulnerability and protect you so that at the state level, even the county level, we can get a better grasp of this and slow this down. So it's all that concept behind flattening the curve. And so, you know, the Safer at Home order that the county and the state has issued is really saying, look, that we understand that there are some essential needs that you have to go out and do. And so it's not your typical errand day. If you need groceries, go to the grocery store. Try to limit how often you go to the grocery store. Don't, you know, overfill your cart. There's plenty of supplies out there. There's plenty of food. In fact, I get emails from the Grocery Association, which we try to post in our community updates, telling us we're earthquake country, and just inherently because of that, our distributors always are well stocked and well prepared, and so it's just prefacing that. And so there are essential things you do if you are having your essential employee for a certain profession, like government employees are essential employees. You're going to have to go to work. You may have to go to the gas station, so the gas station's still open. Mechanic shops, there's certain industries that are open. At a more local level, as we were monitoring what was happening, and from the very beginning of when the Safer at Home order was issued, we realized that in those orders, they were encouraging people to go for walks and to be outdoors and take the time to kind of release that stress and relax. But unfortunately, what we experienced that first weekend was just overwhelming crowds coming to the peninsula, particularly Rancho Palos Verdes. As you know, we have 1,400 acres of open space as part of the nature preserve. We have several parks that have these pastoral and panoramic views, and so it's inherently a place that invites people to come to. And of course, we've learned over the years through social media that Rancho Palos Verdes is now on the map. And so it is paradise. We hear that often. We know that. We live it. But people, as we were approaching the weekend and we knew it was going to be a nice weekend, we were beginning to prepare ourselves. How are we going to deal with the crowds that we anticipated coming? Well, that Saturday, we had all of our facilities open. We had our park bathrooms opened. And as we were monitoring the activity, and I was in constant communication with a lot of the residents that live around some of these open areas, and hearing from them their accounts of what they were observing. The next day, that Sunday, we put in extra measures. We said, okay, we couldn't sustain our parks and our open space areas, couldn't sustain the crowds and the impacts to our environment. And so we closed down the bathrooms. We made some modifications. We posted signs so the people were, as they were approaching our facilities and our park grounds, they were aware of some of these restrictions. That didn't help. And so immediately the next day, and I've been having briefings with a team here at City Hall. We had one that Monday and decided that the best thing to do overall for the city, and I know it impacts our residents, was to close down all of our parks and open space facilities and trails in the interest of everybody else, and really following the Safer at Home order, which eventually carried on. The county ended up doing something similar. The state did something similar. And quite honestly, it was a Herculean effort. And we went through our first weekend with the full closure last weekend. And if you drive around, you've seen all the signs. We have reader boards all over our city entry points. We have banners. We've worked and collaborated with HOAs that are helping us enforce this. We've brought on board the Sheriff's Department, who have been incredible. The neighbors, the residents have been incredible, helping volunteer hours, being out there, being that face to make sure people don't go past our barricades. So there are a lot of efforts that we put in there, and it's paying off. I know it was a very difficult decision to make. I think there are people that are not happy with it, but they understand it's temporary. We will reopen eventually.
Including City Hall.
Yes, including City Hall.
You know, John, you're a businessman. You're at your office now, and you know, we're all focused obviously on the health impact of this first, that everybody's healthy, but the economic situation is going to be devastating in our own city, you know, with quote, non-essential businesses being closed, and of course, Terranea, which gives us so much transient occupancy tax. What is the impact already can you feel that will happen to the city and already planning future projects? Can you kind of go into that for us?
As sure. No, I mean, clearly our hotels are closed down. Our restaurants are closed down except for takeout and to-go. And Terranea, which is obviously the biggest business in our city, where they generate close to $5 million in TOT per year for our city, which is occupancy tax. And, you know, they're closed. And they've advertised to have reservations in mid-May. Of course, that's not going to be, it's going to have to ramp up again. People are going to need to feel comfortable being around one another again in social settings. There'll probably be guidelines set out for that as well, so things won't be the same. So it's going to be a financial change for our city. We're going to lose quite a bit of occupancy tax. I just read something right today that the governor is forgiving 12 months of sales tax from small businesses. Of course, the state collects the sales tax and then that filters back to our city, so we won't be getting that money as well. So we're having a budget workshop the middle of this month. Those advertisements will go out. That'll be a virtual meeting again. And our city council is going to be working with our city manager and his staff to figure out ways in which to really look at our budget and make sure we protect our city budget, because we're going to be taking a big financial hit, and we need to be prepared for that. And so we've been already talking about that quite a bit as, you know, with the city manager and with the mayor pro tem as well. I do want to mention a couple things, though, that I think are positives. With our utility partners, many times we hear negative things about our utility partners. But during this time, even though Southern California Edison does have a lot of pressure on them in terms of the high fire zones and fire safety, they have agreed to not necessarily do some of their plant shutoffs during this time. And so they're mindful of the fact that people are at home and they need power. Also, Cox Communication, that does our cable and internet, they've been working with our city staff to increase internet speeds and to bring better service, because we need that as people are working at home. So, you know, we hear a lot of negatives about our utility companies, but I just wanted to give those two companies a shout out for working with our city in this time and working in a positive way with them. So a lot of challenges ahead, but, you know, our city manager's on top of this, and he's always coming up with good creative things that could possibly help, and we could discuss and work as a community to make sure that we all get through this.
Right. I mean, obviously, every one of us is facing challenges in our own personal lives, whatever, wherever our circumstances are. And these can be really scary times right now on so many levels. And for you are leading the city in this situation, I'm sure incredibly challenging. So I don't know if you could just share a little bit more how you're able to keep the city running and going, and especially with staff remotely, and kind of share with us, especially if people still want to apply for services like a permit with the city, like what should residents do?
Right. Right. Well, you know, and I'm just going to add on to what the mayor had mentioned is, you know, when I got word that Terranea was going to shut down, and it's so disheartening because there were about, I would say, almost 1,200 employees that were furloughed. And you know, Trump National is also shut down, and they're a big employer engine as well. And so immediately I started thinking, okay, what are going to be the ramifications of this? I mean, as with the executive orders coming down and certain non-essential businesses shutting down, that's going to hurt our coffers. When small businesses hurt, we hurt as well. When all of our businesses hurt, we hurt as well. And so it's been something that I've been working with staff here and looking at ways that we can identify savings. Interesting. I mean, how quickly things have turned. I mean, we were gearing up to have our first budget workshop in March, and the conversation we were going to have was going to be, it was very different than what we plan on having at our next at the rescheduled budget workshop on April 13th. And so we're going to be, and it's going to be a virtual meeting. But in terms of City Hall and how we're maintaining operations, we're here for the community. The community needs to know that their government is available, and they can turn to us and they'll get a response from us. And so as things were happening, I realized that there are a couple things that had to be factored in. First and foremost was the safety of everybody. And so knowing what I was hearing and what the recommendations were coming from the public health officials, I was okay. I'm understanding that the social distancing, the physical distancing was really important, the sanitizing, the washing the hands. And so we shut City Hall down to the public, but didn't shut the public out. In other words, we were still coming into work and answering calls and trying to go more electronic communication rather than in-person conversations. People can call us, they can email us. But recognizing that we were still all in the building and still not per se having that separation, what I did is a few days later implemented a telecommuting policy where what I wanted to do is put most staff at home where they're safer and just have key individuals on a rotation cycle come into City Hall to be here to answer any questions, to respond to emails, to continue to provide services to the public, so with minimal disruption. So we're here. There's one or two individuals per division and department. If someone wants to pull a permit, they can schedule an appointment. We're still taking plans in. We will take hard copies in, but there's a way to set that up. You bring it, you leave it outside. We then will collect it after you leave, and the payment is usually made by the phone. But interesting enough is a lot of our transactions, a lot of our activity has migrated over into electronic. And you know, I have to say that our city has always been on the forefront with technology and for years. And you know, I've been with the city for a long time, and the council has always made an effort to fund programs and software to keep us advanced and to be ahead of the game. And it's really paying off now, because one of the things we did last year is we scanned all of our permit files. So when realtors or individuals are interested in getting their permits, staff can do it from their home. They can go into our files, identify that permit, and email it to that individual without ever having to step foot leaving their home or our home and being able to exchange information. So we're really using technology to continue to provide services. It's, again, we're learning, we're adjusting, and the public, I would have to say, has been very supportive and understanding and cooperative.
Right. As the mayor, and you're out in the community, well, as limited as we can be now, John, I'm wondering what kind of feedback you're getting from residents, and Ari, you can also answer this too, just about what we can do more to meet their needs, what are their needs, especially like for our seniors right now, it's like challenging to get groceries, those kinds of basic things. What are we doing as a city, and what are you hearing, John?
Well, there's people out there like Linda Reed with the school board that's been connecting our students that are learning from home now with seniors to be able to help them to get supplies or food to their house. You know, I think really what the citizens want is to know that there isn't chaos out there. And I think I really hats off to our staff again, because you know, getting the information out there, the latest information every day, I think that really keeps people feeling like their city is at least looking out for them. We've had feedback on people that were a little frustrated that our parks were closed, but then when we would explain to them, or the staff or Barra would explain to them that, look, this is a temporary thing, and we all need to go ahead and do our part. And maybe if you're going to take a walk, just walk out in front of your house. I mean, it's, you know, instead of driving over to the park. And I think people have been accepting of that. I think ultimately, though, you know, it's our job as city leaders to also figure out the path forward. How do we help our businesses get back to being what they're doing when the time's right? You know, how do we help people navigate a lot of the changes that are taking place. And so, you know, I look forward to that, obviously, us getting back to some normalcy. And I think a lot of people that I hear from, they're thankful that I did share my story about having the coronavirus and getting better and realizing that the symptoms are, you know, not always exactly what they tell you, but could be something different, and knowing that it's okay for most people and they're going to be okay. And so I think just the idea of not panicking, you know, you go to our city website and Ara doesn't have a big flashing red siren on there. He's just got a nice little subtle button that says get the latest updates. And then you hit that and you know, the page isn't full of fire and brimstone, but it's, you know, just simple, here's the things that are going on. I like the fact that we treat our residents like, you know, adults and people that have earned respect, and we're just giving them information, and when they have questions, we answer them quickly. I think that's what people want, and we're giving that to them.
The city website, rpvca.gov, we can't say that enough, because right. I would have to say kudos to staff, because it's an easy website to navigate. You can go on to learn about COVID-19, how does it spread, what do you do if you think you have it, county links, important links. It's really laid out in a very comfortable way that you feel like, oh, I'm not going to panic. And yeah. That's what it does. It does present that way, but it's right there with all the facts and information. Every day, you're updating it. And so on that note, I want to ask you, Ara, I know you're about to say something, is another way we're communicating is with Alert South Bay. Can you address that? Because that's something I've heard from residents. They're concerned about maybe getting confused about the way they're getting notified. Can you address that?
Yeah, you know, Alert South Bay really was launched at the beginning of March, and it's 12 participating cities within the overall 17 cities that are part of the South Bay COG. And so the original premise of this was really to just send out information on emergencies. And I think what we've all been experiencing, I'm a subscriber and I've been getting all the messages. And the way I subscribed is I actually requested to get information from all the cities. And I did that so that I can stay informed as to what the neighboring cities are doing for my own knowledge. But I think a lot of people have done that. And so they started getting messages daily and maybe every hour from other cities that are using it as a different platform to just push out information, not per se information that's related to an actual emergency. And so we're sort of ironing out the logistics behind that. And you'll see in the coming weeks, things will change. And I think some of the messages that are being pushed out from some of the other South Bay cities is lessening now, because I think they're being told that this is not what the intent is behind Alert South Bay. But with that said, all the South Bay cities that are participating, we pushed out a survey yesterday. Okay. And we, the Rancho Palos Verdes, also sent it out to all of our social media sites, as well as our listserv. And what we're doing is we're trying to gather information from the community as to what they want to hear and what they need from their local city in terms of resources or information. And as the mayor was saying, the school district is helping out with some volunteers. What I've been hearing is the concerns that the community, the questions the community are asking, pertain to the seniors and what resources are available to seniors, as well as our businesses and how our businesses are being affected. And so in terms of our seniors, we collaborating with three other cities on the peninsula, we have collectively put information together with the school district as to what you can do to help seniors and what seniors can do to get help. So that's all on our website. We put it in our daily community update so people can see that readily on a daily basis. In terms of our businesses, you know, we know, and as I mentioned earlier, and as the mayor said, they're struggling, and a lot of our restaurants are struggling. And recognizing that last week, within 24 hours, we pulled together a program with, and when I say we, it was the other cities on the peninsula. So all four of us, in collaboration with the chamber, the Palos Verdes Chamber, we put together a program and launched it. 24 hours later, that was the Takeout Tuesdays and Thursdays. And we decided to say Tuesdays and Thursdays. Yeah, so we did 2 days. I know there are a lot of initiatives out there which are Takeout Tuesdays. We were saying, well, why not Thursday as well? Who wants to cook? This is a great opportunity to reach out to our restaurants on the entire peninsula, not just the ones that you frequent in your city, but look at the neighboring cities. And guess what? You don't have to go to the grocery store. You can just call it in and your food's ready. Just pick it up. You could minimize that exposure. Stay in your car and take that home and not have to worry. So we just want to keep pushing out information. We want to help our businesses. The council on April 7th, they're going to receive a report from staff on some options that they can consider to help our small businesses through this time, sort of like a bridge between getting assistance from the state and the federal, what our city can provide to help them. The last thing we want to do is see our businesses shut down when all of this settles. So we're here to help them out.
Yeah. You mentioned April 7th. That will be your second virtual city council meeting. I watched the first one March 17th. You did a fantastic job. This is a new way to communicate, but it worked.
Thank you. And you know, Liz, we were the first city to really launch that virtual city council meeting. I got to brag because our staff, especially our information technology manager, Lucas, he did within 24 hours, we had my briefing that Monday morning and we said, okay, this is what we're going to do. We've got a full agenda. How are you going to do this with the orders in place to be safer at home? And we orchestrated that virtual meeting. All of our council members were in different locations. Staff were in different locations. And we did we did such a great job conducting that meeting that the following day I had a call with the city managers from the other cities in the South Bay, and I referred them to our website, referred them to Lucas, and so many cities have been reaching out to us to learn how we did it, and so we set the bar again, another area where Rancho Palos Verdes set the bar.
Mr. Mayor, are you going to be doing your virtual running the meeting from your office? Do you have a plan? I mean, how is this going for you, doing it this way? How do you think it's going?
I actually think it's going really well. You know, even, and you guys know I'm a business owner as well, and I've grew up here in Southern California, and I hate traffic like the rest of us. And so we even before this whole thing happened, we were talking about how can we help people work from home and less driving. And, you know, it's unfortunate that it took a pandemic to get to this point. But I think the great thing is that we can all do these virtual meetings and we don't always have to jump in the car to have these discussions. And so, like Ara said, he talked to all these other cities that are now conducting their business virtually. It gives our residents an opportunity to have business in our city. But what's kind of cool is all our residents kind of get a window into all of our lives too, right? So you can kind of see the stuff behind me, and Liz, you've got some neat stuff behind you, and Ara needs some more pictures behind him, but
I haven't had time to settle into my office yet.
Exactly. Well, right. So Ara's not, he didn't even get a chance to put pictures up, and then this pandemic hits.
I would say, I actually said I'm at home. I honestly, since we've had this safer at home order, I really have been here, especially since I wasn't feeling well. I have not really left Seaview other than to kind of walk around the neighborhood, and thank goodness for grocery delivery business and good friends delivering me things like supplements. But we're all figuring out how to navigate, right?
Right. I mean, here's the pitch that, you know, this is obviously, we're going to get back to some business as usual eventually. But for all of you watching this broadcast, you know, when we get back to normal, before you jump in your car and do something, you know, maybe you can visit your friends virtually. You could put your face real close to the camera, and it's kind of fun. You can make silly faces.
High five. I don't know. If we can.
Right? You could do virtual high fives.
Right.
And, you know, in other words, we don't need to be in our cars all the time. And then the other big thing I'm going to say is, as we're all struggling to find toilet paper still, is that, you know, my wife heeded the warnings many, many years ago where they said, you need to be prepared for 30 days if there's an earthquake. And so we've always kept our house stocked with toilet paper and water and all that good stuff. And so when this thing happened, we haven't missed a beat at our house. So I have to give a shout out to our emergency preparedness committee folks that are always trying to push for people to be prepared. And when this thing all levels out and we flatten this curve, get your houses full of toilet paper and other stuff for 30 days or more. Because, you know, you never know when something might happen again. Hopefully it never happens again. Mm-hmm. But the reality is we need to keep being prepared, too. So this is good lessons for us, really. A lot of silver linings.
Silver linings. This is Ara's. You mentioned earlier, he just came on board officially as city manager in February when after this all hit. And, of course, you've been with the city for 21 years. So you are a veteran and a planner, and you're doing a great job at it. I know you actually just before all this happened, you were presenting to the Council of Homeowners just sort of an update on the city with all this great presentation. I don't know if you want to share a few highlights of just good news to think about that's happening in RPV that from that presentation especially.
Yeah, you know, I have been with the city for 21 years. September will be 22 years. And I was with the Community Development Department, and I'm a planner by trade. And so I have gone to CHOA numerous times. I think this last January when I attended the meeting was my 12th time presenting at CHOA. But all the past times I've gone to CHOA, it's always been to talk about planning related issues. And so the day I went and spoke to CHOA was actually my first full day on the job as the city manager. So I was really actually quite proud to be standing there in front of so many. There were like 40 people there that evening, which John Manitakis had told me like that was almost like a record number of attendees. I'm not saying why they came out, but there was a lot of people that came out that
it's
evening.
For you, Ara.
I'm not saying that.
Don't be modest.
It was great because when I stood up there and I looked out, there were so many people that I knew and that I have interacted with, and so it just reinforced my belief and my passion for the city and what I was doing and speaking to them in terms of a city manager. Now I wanted to share information to CHOA, who I see as being a conduit to our community between the city and the community, because they're all the HOA representatives. They pass information on to the residents. So I took this as an opportunity to share with this group what's happening in Rancho Palos Verdes, what's happening in your city. And there's a lot happening. And up until that point, there was a lot of, you know, a lot of moving parts, and we were working on park projects. So I wanted to highlight some of the things that they could see in the future happening, you know, some of the initiatives with undergrounding utilities. I know the mayor's heavily involved in that. And so I wanted to highlight some of the things that are happening with undergrounding. I wanted to talk about housing. Housing is a big subject. You know, the mayor brought this up earlier. You know, when things settle down and we resume some sort of normalcy, these issues are still going to have to be addressed. And so I talked about housing, whether it was the regional housing needs assessment or ADUs. I mean, these are things that our planning commission is currently reviewing. And they're still meeting and talking about these things, even though we're basically operating in a very different way right now. I talked about some of the issues pertaining to public safety. And, you know, we've got the Ring Doorbell Subsidy Match program that I think ends it next week. And so this is our second or third round out there. We're really trying to get people to take advantage of this opportunity to help harden their home from a security standpoint. We also talked about Alert South Bay and how we launched that earlier in March. I wanted to give the members there the heads up. Hey, this is how you subscribe to it. Pass this message out. You can get it on via email. You can get it on the phone. So I just wanted to go over these issues here. And I know I hope, and I've always told the members of CHOA that I'm more than happy to come speak at their next meeting, any of the meetings, because there's always a lot to talk about.
Well, it's going to have to be, at this point, a virtual meeting with CHOA, right? You know, you mentioned
we're prepared. We can do it.
Not to bat out of order. You know, we've mentioned Alert South Bay a couple times, and you know, the mayor is an expert at setting it up on his phone. We try to help do it live during a City Talk show. And so just now, just to residents might be listening to this and saying, what are they saying, Alert South Bay? So it's an app that you put on your phone. Do you want to explain that before we wrap it up here?
Yes, correct. It's an app, and you can subscribe to it to receive messages on your phone or to receive messages via email. So it's really a conduit of whenever there's an incident, if there's an earthquake or if there's a fire and you need to know how to evacuate, this is a source of getting that information to you immediately. And Liz, I just want to say, I mean, to subscribe, you go to the city's website, there's a step-by-step process on how to subscribe, whether it's online or whether you're using your phone.
Okay. Or they can call John.
Yeah.
I want to also add, gentlemen, that another great way our city is communicating is this is every quarter we put out this new city newsletter. And I have to say, I'm super impressed that this came out with all this COVID-19 information. We were ahead of it then. And there's so much information in here, you know, updates on what's going on in the city, to the landslide, to the civic center, all that stuff. But and also city events. You might want to reference a lot of events are canceled, correct?
That is correct, Liz. I mean, the events that we had scheduled for April, such as the Easter Egg Extravaganza, as well as the Whale of the Day event, which we have every year, has been canceled in light of the Safer at Home orders. And I want to add that with this newsletter, you know, we usually are in production and preparing this weeks, almost like a couple months in advance of it being released. And as this news was breaking, we made last minute changes to include the information on COVID-19 so that when this came out to the public, they had up-to-date information on this.
I want to say we're talking about cancellations, but Mr. Mayor, I hope you're going to be there for 4th of July, that we're still going to have our 4th of July party. That'll be something to look forward to, right?
Oh, we all look forward to the 4th of July party. Go America.
All right, we have to wrap it up, and I know you're just talking about it, but I want to make sure the mayor gets the last word. Any final announcements from the city manager? Today, April 2nd, information is changing daily. In fact, I think today I heard, was it from the White House, that a report came out that now it's not just being 6 feet apart is safe enough, that just by speaking and this virus can get out there just from breathing. So people are just hearing more and more information. It keeps changing. But on that note, what is today you'd like to kind of share? Sort of your last message, maybe when even City Hall might reopen.
Well, you're right. I mean, what we're hearing from the professionals out there, the is constantly changing. I mean, it all started with that 6 foot social separation, and now we're hearing within the last 24 hours about wearing masks when you're out doing the essential errands that you do. And so, I would suggest and highly recommend. As we learn this information here at City Hall, and we're monitoring it constantly, and we've got a great team that's doing that, we'll put that in our community updates to keep you informed. I think what I really want to end with is just to convey how proud I am of our community and our residents and their cooperation and assistance in getting us through this. I can't tell you the volume of emails I'm getting from people who want to help, who are sharing information to me on areas that we need to pay attention to, or some things that we may have overlooked, and I think it takes a community and it takes a collective effort to get us through this. And I mentioned earlier, this is an exercise. We are actually going through an emergency right now, so it's not no drill and no rehearsal. It is real life, and we need everyone to pull together, help your neighbors, be there for each other, heed to the orders that are being issued. They're for your safety. Our facilities are closed, not because we want to take that privilege away from you, but because we want to protect you. And so I want the public to say, I want to say thank you, and to just stay safe, stay well, and stay at home if you can.
Thank you for that. And really important what you're saying. We as a community need to be together and help each other. It takes a village. And John, you're one of the leaders in the village right now as the mayor. How about your final thoughts as we just wrap this edition up, in terms of what you think the city is doing to really help our community navigate this new way of life?
Well, I mean, clearly we're in good hands with Ara and his team. And I can't thank him and the city staff enough. And I agree with Ara that our residents have been very, very patient, and they've been following directions the best they can. I know they want to get back to normalcy, and I'll let the community know that our city council is working not only to make sure that our city has the resources to do the things to keep us safe now, but we're also looking to the future and realizing that what's happening now is going to affect our city for many months and maybe years to come. And so we are mindful of that. We do need more than just 5 city council members. We need our whole community to come together and work together to make sure that we all get through this safely. And then at the end of the day, we maintain our wonderful city of Rancho Palos Verdes. This is my 1 year to be mayor, and I'm so happy that I am mayor right now, because I feel like it's not about me. It's about making sure that our team of wonderful professionals at City Hall get the resources they need and get the support they need, you know, not just financially, but of course, you know, morally and mentally and personally, because this is a lot they've been going through. And so I can't thank them enough. And I can't thank our residents enough, and I want people to stay safe, and we're all going to get through this. We're going to get back to some type of normalcy. And so, you know, keep doing what you're doing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I want to say 2020 was supposed to be the year you were mayor, not the year that you got coronavirus, but I'm glad you're healthy. And you know what, as they say, life is what happens to us. We're all making a different plan, but we're pulling together, and I want to thank you for all both of you are doing, and I'm grateful to be part of the city team as well, and we're all going to do our part, and just want to keep putting out that website again to the residents that are looking for information, rpvca.gov. We're going to try to keep regularly updating everybody on RPV TV and on the city through Facebook and all the social media outlets, and just doing our part, and we will get through this, and there's light at the end of the tunnel, right, as they say? All right.
With absolutely.
Everyone out there, I wish everyone well. Be healthy. Be safe. Spread the love, not the virus. Remember to keep washing those hands. And thanks for tuning in to us here on RPV TV. Have a great day, everyone. Be safe.